Hey everyone, welcome back to Vintage. It's been a busy old week already, hasn't it? Well, it has for me anyway. I hope it has for you. The beginning of the week, on Tuesday night, we had the announcement of the Costa Book of the Year. Vintage were obviously very excited. Two books in the running. Keggy Carew's Dadland had won the Biography Prize and Alice Oswald's collection Falling Awake had won the Poetry Prize. So they were both in the running for the Book of the Year. It was Sebastian Barry's Days Without End that actually triumphed on the night. I haven't read it, but I have read some of his other novels, and I do love what he's doing with his novels, which is that they're all connected. They all tell the stories of various members of these two families, the Duns and the McNultys. So I really love that. I think that, you know, when you have this huge body of work towards the end of his writing career, he will have achieved something really quite incredible. Also, his book, A Long, Long Way, is one of the few books to actually make me cry whilst reading it. It doesn't happen very often, and I know he'll be very happy to have won £30,000 from the Costa Book Award, but I think the real accolade here is that he wrote a book that made me cry. Anyway, congratulations to him. I've managed to snaffle a copy of that, so I'll be reading that at some point in the future. Lots of good things said about Golden Hill by Francis Spufford as well, which won the debut novel award. Managed to snaffle a copy of that too, because I'm a bit of a book thief. If you want to know more about Dadland and Falling Awake, there are all sorts of fantastic things that you can read and watch and listen to. There will be links down below and indeed above my head. I particularly recommend listening to Alice Oswald reading from her collection, because she's got this amazing voice. It's just completely mesmeric. So if you need a bit of poetry to chill you out, the link to follow is that one down below. Anyway, last week I was talking about Xiaolu Guo's Once Upon a Time in the East, her memoir, although there was this discussion about whether it was a memoir or what she prefers to call it, which is a prose essay. Anyway, the most important thing is that it's a fantastic book. I had two copies to give away, and the people winning those copies are Draw Your Book and William Bruce. So congratulations to both of you. You will find my email address in the description below. You can send me your postal addresses and I'll get copies of that book off to you as soon as I can. This week, I'm talking about another book which sort of plays with its form. It is a novel, but it's very much an autobiographical novel. And this is a very European thing. So in the UK, we're like, this is fiction, this is non-fiction, and that's just how it goes. In Europe, they have far more fluid boundaries, and in fact, there is something called autofiction in a lot of countries, which is fiction based on autobiography. I would say, you know, Carl Ove Knausgård or even Rachel Cusk would be examples of that that you can read in this country from Vintage. And now to add to that, we have The End of Eddy by Édouard Louis, which is based on Édouard's own childhood in northern rural France. It's caused quite a bit of controversy in France, this book, because of what it depicts, but also because of this blurring of boundaries in terms of whether it is fiction or not fiction, or whether it's true or not. I got the chance to speak to Édouard about this book a few months ago, and in fact that interview is up on the Vintage website, so I'll put a link down below. I really recommend reading it. I asked him about this blurred boundaries thing, and he absolutely insisted that every single word in this book is true. Everything that happens in the book happened to him, which is really interesting. The book itself is absolutely knockout. It's a very, very powerful book, and it's all sorts of reasons for that. As I said, it's set in northern rural France, and it is about his childhood, and it is about how it felt to be a young gay boy desperately trying to sort of fit in with everybody else. He hates the fact that he's got this high effeminate voice and this sort of camp manner about him, and he just wants to be normal. So it is not a story about how one boy is different and achieves success by showing his difference. It's almost the opposite. It's about somebody desperate to fit in, desperate not to be thought of as different. And it's also about the casual racism and homophobia that he has to deal with every day. It is about extreme poverty. And crucially, it is about how poverty and lack of education and ignorance and being sidelined allows people to develop extremely racist or homophobic ideas and attitudes. And he's very clear in the interview that we had about the fact that what he is trying to do is to give these people a voice. And what he means by that is that we are very used to reading the thoughts and opinions of certain types of people in the newspaper or seeing them on the news. And these would be your establishment, white, middle-class people in this country. And what you don't hear are the thoughts and the opinions of people outside of that very often. That is why we had such a divisive campaign around Brexit, because there was a huge group of the population who were sick of the fact that nobody listened to what they had to say. And that actually can lead to a sort of almost a more extreme set of views being espoused and spoken when they get a chance, because they have been sort of left to talk amongst themselves, you know what I mean? And they often, there's not a rounded enough debate about certain things. And these views haven't been challenged because nobody has asked them what they think. And there's absolutely loads of this in this book. And there's also this really interesting thing about when people say one thing and you wonder where that's come from. And one example of that is his father, who says all the time about, you know, about killing gay people or locking people up who are terrorists or Arabs or whatever it might be. Really, really vociferous about these things. And then there is an episode in the book where this young lad gets beaten up because of being gay. And his father steps in amongst these people and says, leave him alone. If you touch him one more time, I'll kill every last one of you. And so Eddie is sort of confused about who this man is, this father of his, who can say one thing and then act in a completely different way. And there's also a really interesting idea about his ideas about race when he discovers from his mother that his father had a friend that he'd made when he was living down in the south of France who was black. And so there's a real question about how does that square with the sort of casual racism that he spews all the time. So a really, really interesting book, sort of on a level like that, but very, very stylishly written as well in terms of its fiction content. I really recommend reading the interview. There is also an extract from the book, which I've kind of almost told you all of through this video, but you can get a really good idea of the style of the book from reading that extract. So links for both of those things will be down below. And that's all I will say about the book for now. I have a couple of copies to give away as ever. So if this sounds like the kind of thing you'd be interested in, I think it's really interesting for all sorts of reasons, particularly those ideas about sexuality. So for those who are looking for a read that would be LGBTQ sort of category, I would really recommend this. But I'd say also those ideas about poverty and racism, homophobia, where those things come from, the sidelined voices of the working classes and the poor. I think it's just fantastic. So there we go. That is The End of Eddy. If you're interested, make sure you're subscribed. Leave a comment below and I'll pick two winners next week. Whilst we're talking about subscriptions, just very briefly, a small plea. I noticed the other day that we had just tipped over 4,700 subscribers here, which is so tantalisingly close to 5,000, which is just a really lovely round number, and I would love to get there. So, if you like these vlogs, please tell your friends. If you're on other social media, do a little tweet or a thing or a something, or if you're on Facebook, with maybe a little link through to the Vintage YouTube channel, because I would love to get more people watching. I would love to get more people discussing. I love reading your comments and replying to them when I can. I would just love to get more people here. And if we hit that 5K, who knows, I might do some kind of insane, massive giveaway with lots of books to lots of people. How does that sound? Deal? It's a good deal. So please spread the word. That is all for this week, and I will see you next week. Take care.